The next item of business is a motion to approve a statutory rule. I remind members that this debate was adjourned for 7 days on Monday, the 16th of January, in accordance with Standing Order 16. Members will wish to note that our standing orders require that a member may speak only once during a debate on a motion. Only members who didn't speak during this debate on Monday, the 16th, will be allowed to speak during today's debate. For members' convenience, I will ask the clerk to read the motion into the record once again.
That the draft Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme Amendment Regulations Northern Ireland 2017 be approved.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Gordon Dunn.
I welcome the opportunity to speak on this important piece of business in the House today, and I would thank the Minister for his work in bringing this forward. These regulations are an important step in introducing effective and realistic cost controls to reduce both the burden upon our budget and also to help bring controls to the scheme. I know the Minister and his officials have been working extensively on bringing forward these proposals and have rightly taken time to ensure they are compliant and effective. I believe these plans will run from April 2017 to April 2018 and will start the journey towards a longer-term solution to further reduce the public expenditure on this scheme. There is no doubt that these actions had to be taken to reduce the pressure on public sector budgets, whilst ensuring those who have acted in good faith by investing in technology and equipment are not unfairly penalised. On Thursday last, 19th of January 2017, the Economy Committee heard a presentation from the Renewable Heat Association, who outlined how they had seen the boilers as effective in meeting the energy needs of the various sectors, including poultry and mushroom production. They also raised genuine concerns about the potential impact of the revised tariffs for the businesses which they represent, and I trust that these can be worked on through in the days ahead. When the renewable heating incentive was introduced, there were many calls to try and move away from an over-reliance on imported fossil fuels. The intentions of the scheme were clearly to try and move away from this reliance on fossil fuels and look at renewable energy as a way of meeting the energy needs of, firstly, the non-domestic sector in 2012 and then the domestic sector later in 2014. A target to increase the level of renewable heat to 10% by 2020 was included in the Strategic Energy Framework, and an interim target of 4% renewable heat by 2015 was also included in the then programme for government to help the UK meet its 15% renewable energy targets. Despite these targets being in place, initial interest and uptake in the scheme was low, and there appeared to be reluctance among the business community to go with the significant investment that was required to install the necessary equipment. One point which was raised at the Economy Committee by the group last Thursday was the reduction in oil prices, resulting in the cost of pellet production being reduced significantly. Therefore, the scheme did become more attractive. There is no doubt that mistakes and errors have been made within the RHI scheme. That was widely acknowledged by Arlene Foster in this House on the 19th of December and by our Economy Minister. The lack of cost control measures and flaws in its design have been acknowledged, and at a recent meeting of the Public Accounts Committee, we heard from the Permanent Secretary, who stated the intention of the scheme was good, but the execution and design were seriously wrong. In relation to controls and measures relating to the design of the RHI scheme, the Detty business case was presented to DFP on the 9th of March 2012. In the executive summary, it states in paragraph 232, tiering is not included in the Northern Ireland scheme because, in this instance, the subsidy rate is lower than the incremental cost. Digression, something which has been debated at length, was also considered at paragraph 755, which stated that degression is a mechanism whereby tariffs would be automatically reduced on an annual basis to reflect and to potentially encourage the reduction of technology costs for renewable heating. Paragraph 756 states, at this stage, DETI does not propose to include built-in degression into the Northern Ireland RHI legislation. However, they may consider the need to do so in the future. The internal DETI casework committee considered these proposals on the 9th of March 2012 and approved the NI RHI RHPP scheme and administration arrangements with Ofgem. It is now therefore clear from the information detailed in the approved DETI business case that tiering of payments and degression were not included in the design of the RHI scheme. There were clear risks from the start, with two bodies involved in managing the scheme. DETI was responsible for the policy framework, while Ofgem, acting as the administrator, managing the applications and installations, including compliance. There were risks of ownership and responsibility within the scheme. Department officials admitted poor management of the scheme with no clear project management in place, which would have involved regular management review of all risks, including finance and quality. It would appear from the information we've gathered that some farmers and some industrial operators saw RHI as an income generator rather than as a means to reduce the cost of energy in their business, which was a key rationale behind the introduction of the scheme in the first place. Lessons must be learned, Mr. Speaker, from the scheme, and corrective actions put in place to stop the recurrence of such a system failure in the future. And that is why I welcome these regulations coming forward today, and I trust these plans will provide a roadmap and an important first step towards dealing with this problem, and will gain the support of this House today. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Ms. Emma Pengelly.
Mr. Speaker, I rise to welcome the proposals from the Economy Minister today. Firstly, and as I stated last week, I welcome the acknowledgement in his statement of regret and the acknowledgement that there were serious mistakes leading to the perverse incentives to overuse heat. This was clearly not the intention. As I also stated last week, good policy development and design is absolutely essential to changing outcomes for the better and for good government policies and interventions. The process for good policy design failed in this case, with the tariff issue not being identified at the time as necessary. An inquiry will find out why this process failed and what lessons must be learned moving forward. The regulations brought forward today will hopefully start to deal as soon as possible to reduce any Northern Ireland liability for additional cost. However, it is only one part of the issue. There will be much to be considered and questions to be asked on this issue. How did this happen? Why was the tariff removed by officials? Why did officials recommend a policy design without the tariff? Did this issue come up during the committee evidence and those that were called before the committee? Why did the safeguards and scrutiny mechanisms fail to identify the tariff issue at the time when the policy design was agreed? These are important and critical issues for all of us here. The evidence to the PAC on Wednesday clearly highlights that this was not a failing by just one person. Regardless of your view, and I've heard many different views across all of the parties on ministerial responsibility, and also the clear desire constantly articulated by many around this chamber to blame just one person, I would respectfully and strongly say that this will not solve the issue. It is clear from the evidence to the PAC, the evidence in front of the committee, and the discussions so far that this was a failure in process. And blaming just one person for that will not resolve the failings in that process. I know that all of us want to have good policy design. And for good policy design and good policies, we need to make sure that process is right. The design process by officials and consultants failed. the business case scrutiny process did not identify the problems. All of the evidence given to the committee didn't inform the recommendation, and remember that the committee recommended the design of this. A very interesting aspect to note about this, and there has been discussion across this chamber thus far in relation to the role of the committee. And I say this not to blame others for the mistakes that were made, but to highlight that mistakes were made by everybody in terms of this process. But the committees set up under the Good Friday Agreement and the Northern Ireland Act 1998, the committees of this Northern Ireland Assembly have a very different role from some other committees with other assemblies and parliaments. The roles of committees of this chamber, of the Northern Ireland Assembly, were to be collaborative. They were to work together in terms of policy design. And that is absolutely clear in the legislation, where the role of committees, the statutory duty of committees, is not just to scrutinise. The statutory role of committee is to help ministers in the development and formulation of policy. And that is a critical difference. And it's a difference that means that all of us, all of those parties that sat in those committees, cannot brush off the responsibility in relation to that policy development. And this is important because all of us are human. All of us are capable of making mistakes. And that's why we have the safeguards in place. If people didn't make mistakes, if policy design didn't have some flaws, if all of these issues could be identified by just one person, then why do we have scrutiny? Why would we set up these safeguards? The very reason that they are there is to protect against that from happening. But all of that failed in this case. Just last week, Jim Allister said in this chamber that the executive had failed, but on the whole, the scrutiny of the Northern Ireland Assembly had worked, and on the whole, that the legislative process of the Assembly had worked. We have to be honest about this, all of us and every party around this chamber. The policy design and proposal went to the executive, and the entire executive agreed that. The policy design and proposals went to the committee. Unlike the minister, the committee had the capability, and they took that opportunity, to call evidence from people who were impacted by the scheme, the experts in relation to the scheme, the technical advice from officials. And that committee, on questioning all of that evidence and listening on first hand to the key stakeholders, looked at the original flawed design and said, we agree that this is a good design, in line with their statutory duty to help formulate government policy and help the minister. They recommended that original design under the chairmanship of the SDLP and that committee, with all parties, with the exception, I think, of the Alliance on that, but all the rest of the parties across this chamber on that committee. So that scrutiny did not work. But it didn't stop there. The policy proposal went through the business case process. Experts in our system, in terms of economists, in terms of specialists, in terms of civil servants. And I have had the opportunity both to serve as a special advisor and also as a minister. And I know how challenging and how difficult it can be to get that policy through a business case process, because that is the process where all of these questions are asked. But furthermore, it's not just about policy, it's about the economics of it. Trained professional economists look at this, they do the figures in terms of the business cases, they work out the sums, they try to identify flaws. That process did not identify the tariff issue. That was a failure in terms of the business case process, and we all need to know why, because I know we all want good policies and good initiatives that meet the outcomes that are set down for them. But again, it didn't stop there. The policy proposal, after being cleared by the officials, after going to the committee where evidence was heard and a recommendation to support went back to the department, after going through the business case process, it came to this House, this scrutiny House. But Jim Allister has indicated that it's good in terms of scrutiny, good in terms of legislative processes, and I have no doubt that in terms of the work of this chamber, that there was a pack and research completed, that was made available to all members around this House, that members read that. They looked at the regulations, they looked at the proposals, and this House all of the parties across this House supported the original flawed scheme. Yes.
The member may recall that her party colleague, William McRae, used to sing a little song called Excuses, Excuses. Doesn't that sum up exactly her speech and that of Mr. Dunn this morning, trying to spread the blame to everyone else and running away from the reality that it was Arlene Foster, and Arlene Foster alone was the minister, and alone signed off this scheme without the cost controls. No matter who else might try to smear, that is the irreducible reality.
Okay, thank you for your comment in relation to this, and I had hoped that you would have listened to what I had said. And what I had said was this, that this is not all of the evidence, and I do think this has to go above and beyond party politics. We have to step back and look objectively at the evidence before us, at the evidence in front of the PAC, the evidence that we've all heard. This was not a failing of a single individual. We have had the permanent secretary of the department go to PAC last week and highlight that the recommendation to the minister clearly indicated that recommendation did not have the tariff issue involved in it. It did not have the tariff recommended to the minister. We have to ask the question why. Regardless, if you were right, Jim, and one person was removed, that wouldn't change the fact that the officials' team failed to recommend a tariff involved in this. The business case process failed to identify this. The committee, in listening to the evidence, failed to pick this up. This is not just about one individual. And if we think it is, then we are destined to make the same mistakes again, because we are all human. Everybody is capable of making a mistake. Everybody is capable of following the recommendations of officials, of the experts, because that's what we are told we should do. But there's also a safeguard that recommendation is questioned and interrogated by this House, by the committee, and by the processes that we have set up. It's not about excuses. It is about being objective. It's about being honest. And, you know, do you know what? I may not be back. None of us. There's going to be many people across this chamber. 18 will not be back in terms of this assembly. Regardless of that, regardless of the party politics, regardless of what my own personal role, there are important lessons for us all to learn, above and beyond party politics, because we need and we want good policy in Northern Ireland. We need and we want good initiatives in Northern Ireland, and that must require good processes, the best people in terms of the experts being able to feed through the right recommendations for us to take. Sorry, Stephen had indicated first.
For giving way, she was making the point that one person wasn't to blame. Apart from the fact there were those, including myself, who did raise issues at the scheme early on, but it was one person who, once this became public knowledge, who didn't accept responsibility as minister, who kept trying to put the blame on civil servants, the media, the opposition and everyone else, and one person who refused to step up and take responsibility, and that's why that one person is currently in the dock.
Well, I think in response to that, I feel if we look back over the course of the last number of months, there has been a campaign to blame this all on one person, when all of the evidence is patently, absolutely patently to the contrary, that this was a failure of process. And there's a number of ex-ministers that sit around this chamber who know the way that the process works. And if you've got policy experts and you've got an official energy team and you've got a business case cleared set of recommendations and it's coming to you as minister, then ministers need to be able to rely on that advice. Yes, question it. But we've got a whole system in place to safeguard and to question. But if we can't rely and we can't have credible advice and recommendations coming forward, then we have to question why those people are there in the first place. So there has been a problem in terms of the process. We need to identify why. And just blaming one person will not solve that. Sorry, John.
I thank the member for giving way. And would the member agree with me, in order to build trust within the Assembly with the electorate, that issues like No risk registers being identified, due diligence and good governance were all failures of the Assembly and of the Executive in terms of this RHI scheme.
Okay, well, I think you raise a very interesting point, because in terms of risk registers, in terms of single responsible owners, in terms of project management, that is not a matter, to be honest, for the Executive or for a Minister. That is very much the part and process of departmental. So, I'm answering you absolutely honestly about this. In terms of policy development within departments, it is very rare, in fact, I know of very few, if any, examples where a minister would sit on a project board within a department in terms of policy development, or programme board in terms of development. There is a team of officials that are put in place, an SRO is identified, and the risk register comes back to that project or programme board. Sure. In some cases, a minister might, depending on the issue. But in my experience, certainly, the vast, vast majority of project or programme boards do not include ministers. It's very much part of the process in terms of policy development to develop up the policy, which is then put in recommendations to the minister.
I do not accept that major items, major financial items, would have been clearly indicated in a risk register which would have been brought to ministerial attention, particularly after the scale of the problem was highlighted to the Department of Finance, and that the Ministers of Finance for some time would have known that this is one huge item of risk which was not addressed, and there have been multiple members in that position.
Just before the member, I have been very liberal in terms of where the debate has been going. Both questions and the member come back to the regulations.
Thank you. Certainly, you know, and we had an emergency meeting of the Finance Committee on last week, and also then the scheduled meeting on Wednesday, and particularly in relation to the budget issue. We emphasised to the Permanent Secretary of the Finance Department that there must be a risk register. That risk register must identify all risks. It's clear from the evidence to the PAC that there wasn't a risk register in this case. The responsibility of that risk register lies with, in terms of project management, lies with what is referred to as an SRO. An SRO is always an official in relation to project management and project development. So I think questions need to be asked as to why that didn't happen. And I know that within the civil service, and I'm sure in terms of the leadership within the civil service, those issues are being reviewed. And this is not a case, and I want to be very clear, this is not a case of blaming officials entirely for this. What I have indicated is that there is a whole chain and a process, and throughout that chain and process, these flaws were not identified as an issue by none of us.
The member quite rightly refers to good policy and good policy making, and refers to business cases, and that obviously good policy was not applied in this instance. But looking at the motion in front of us today and the amendment to the regulation, can the minister talk directly to that and explain to the House why she is asking us to depart from good lawmaking, and without a business case and without the necessary statutory requirements that would constitute good lawmaking? Why then in this instance does she think bad policy should be followed through by bad legislation?
I'd like to thank the member for my promotion, and I'm not the minister in relation to this, but certainly in terms of this issue, and I am going to come to that, and I will come back to speaking about the regulations. I just want to set out the context, so I will refer to that in due course, and if the member wants to make a specific intervention at that point, I'm happy to take that. In relation to where we got to in terms of the original policy proposal, I've outlined the process, and I do think objectively, I'm saying this absolutely honestly in terms of everybody around this chamber, I think it's in all of our interests to find out what happened. And an inquiry will do that, and lessons must be learned about that. But there's also additional issues. And again, in terms of what has been discussed, we need to find out what happened in relation to the emails from the whistleblower. We have to find out what procedure was activated. Did officials take it seriously? What follow-up did they do? What process was subsequently followed? What information did the minister get about that? So those are all additional questions that an inquiry will have to look at. But an inquiry must examine all of those issues, and that is the other part of the essential work that needs to happen here in terms of running alongside these regulations and the rollout of this policy. Today I do want to focus on the regulations, and at the heart of the regulations today is one of a principle of fairness. I welcome these proposals. Having been scrutinised legally, and we've had the confirmation by the Minister that these have been scrutinised legally, that these attempt to ensure fairness and to bring the scheme back to the original policy intention. That is clearly in the public interest. However, I also welcome that this is a time-limited nature, the time-limited nature of these regulations, allowing some time for analysis to ensure that the proposed 12% return is indeed fair. And we have seen over the course of the last week some concern by some, legitimately one assumes in terms of partaking in the RHI scheme, the concerns about a reduction of a tariff. And I think that that's why it's important to emphasise, and as the Minister has done, that at the very heart of this is one of fairness. This isn't about saying that there will be no incentive. This is about bringing it back to the original policy intentions to ensure there is an incentive, but that incentive is fair and proportionate, and it's in the public interest in terms of the funds in relation to this matter. I think that is the right approach. It is only for 12 months. I'm sure the Minister will speak to this in due course in relation to a review of that to see then how that will inform the process moving forward and the further rollout. But the aim of this is not only about fairness, but to try insofar as possible. And I welcome that the Minister has been very confident about this, that we will be able to, and through these regulations and the further steps, bring the cost of RHI to as close as possible 0% to the Northern Ireland taxpayer. And I have been out there, we've all been out there, there is a great deal of concern out there in relation to these public funds, a great deal of concern in relation to this £500 million figure. And we have sought to assure people that this, at the moment, yes, it's contractually committed. However, we will do all in our power to bring this down as close as possible to no liability to the Northern Ireland taxpayer. That money has not been spent, and that is the critical issue here. That money can be mitigated, it can be prevented from going out the door in a way that is fair and in a way that is in the public interest. Yes.
Thank you very much indeed. You will be aware, of course, that we've managed to spend £30 million this year alone, and we're spending £85,000 a day, and there is no business case or business plan going forward. And indeed, we also have legal opinion that this plan may indeed be subject to challenge. How do you, would you tie that with what you just said?
Will the member give way?
Yes.
I thank the member for giving way. The member was maybe too busy chairing the committee this morning that he didn't hear from the Permanent Secretary, who said that there was a business case and that, in the view of the Permanent Secretary, the business case ticked all the boxes in terms of value for money, in terms of regularity and propriety. So those things are already there, and there is a business case. Isn't it a bit misleading for the member to say that?
Ask the member to resume his seat.
Look, I thank the members for their interventions. And what I would say is very clearly, it is rarely possible. I want to respond to your initial question first. But it is rarely possible to design something that can fully eliminate the risk of legal challenge. And very often, if you're trying to do anything different, if you're trying to bring forward something new, very often you will hear people say, look, there'll be a risk of legal challenge on this. And in this case, it is particularly challenging. There's no doubt about that. There is a contract in place. But we all must remember that contracts can be broken, but only where it is fair, where it is proportionate. And I would argue very strongly that in this case, it is fair, it is proportionate, but most importantly of all, it is clearly in the public interest to do that. And in my view, yes, there will always be a risk of legal challenge. I think the more important question here is what is the risk of successful legal challenge? Because people can take a case, and I think that in doing anything which is worth doing, that may challenge in terms of these types of issues, doing anything which is in the public interest in relation to this matter, you will have people who will try to challenge it. Now, there's no predicting what a judge will do, and we've seen a number of cases in recent years where perhaps the judge has gone in a particular direction not predicted by those legal advisers, and not least in relation to the roads and infrastructure issue when the Ulster Unionist Party held the DRD post, where there's been surprising outcomes to some of those court cases. So yes, you know, there is a risk of challenge. You can't predict what a judge can do or will do in that situation. But what I would say is that I welcome that the Minister has outlined that his legal team has scrutinised this in great detail. He has received legal advice that though there may be a risk of legal challenge, in the view of the Minister, which he has outlined, and in my view on looking at this, this gives us the strongest possible legal defensible position in terms of breaking those contracts. Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed for those comments. But I think just for clarity, the fact that the business case has not yet been passed by the Department for Finance, and the fact that our advice is very clearly that the risk for this entire process lies with the Minister and nobody else.
Well, in terms of the business case, I think it is disappointing that the business case has not yet been cleared. It's not unusual that business cases, and I'm sure all of us on committees looking at these processes, I know certainly looking across the chamber to the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party, having been chair of the OFM-DFM committee and examining and questioning officials about the business case processes on many, many issues, it can be frustrating how slow that process is. However, the business case process has been looked at by officials within the civil service. I suspect very strongly that if they are taking legal advice about this, they'll be taking legal advice from the solicitors within the system in terms of the Departmental Solicitor's Office. I am assuming, and perhaps the Minister can confirm for me in due course, but that the Department of the Economy has also taken advice from those same team of lawyers. So I would like to think that in that situation the legal advice will be consistent. And the legal advice very clearly here appears to be that there is a strong defensible case to break these contracts in this way, to put a variation on those contracts, to ensure that there is still a return. And I think this is absolutely important. There will still be a return for people of, as the Minister has outlined, 12%. And that still represents an incentive. However, if there are cases and if there's quirks, or if there are issues that emerge over the course of the next 12 months in terms of the businesses who have partaken in this scheme, that there is some form of unfairness, then because this is only a 12-month scheme, that can be fed into the design process for the longer-term or permanent set of arrangements around this. And I think that is the right thing to do. But I am disappointed that the business case is not yet through, but I remain confident that it will be, because the biggest issue here is the one around the legality of the variation of contracts, and they will be seeking the advice from the same place, presumably, as the Minister and the Department also has. And that legal advice is informing this process. We've heard that in the Minister's opening comments as well, that this will be a robust and defensible set of regulations. I also welcome that the Minister has outlined clearly that it has not been the case that no action had been taken up to this point. It wasn't the case that these regulations were just created over the course of the last number of days or weeks. He has outlined a wide range of actions, including increased audit and investigation, and I think all of us will look forward to seeing the results of that. The change scheme implemented and now closed to new applicants, and the now recalibrated cost control proposals contained in these regulations. I think all of us would have liked to see these issues in a swifter way, but I welcome the fact that, and I think it is absolutely essential as previously outlined, that this did go through a process of officials' examination, of legal examination, and informing on those recommendations being given to the Minister in relation to this. I previously mentioned, and I think it's worth putting very clearly on the record, that the DUP aim in all of this, and I would like to think all of our aim in terms of looking at these regulations, and that's why I hope these regulations do get the support of everybody around this chamber, that the aim here is to reduce to zero any cost to the Northern Ireland budget. These measures are a critical step in that, sitting alongside the increased fraud and fair usage investigations, which the Minister has outlined will happen. I also outlined last week that I was saddened, and I remain saddened, that this policy issue and the associated mistakes have brought us to this point. I said very clearly that, and I think all of us can accept that as true, that mistakes do happen. Our processes, teams, committees are made up of fallible human beings. However, the design of our processes are as they are to try to pick those up. Our processes are designed to identify and refine policy and to examine it from every angle. But when the safeguards fail, and there's no doubt that the safeguards failed to pick up this issue in this case, then what we needed were calm heads and a sensible approach to rectifying this. We needed a mature, calm and appropriate approach that required two things. Firstly, as soon as possible, an independent and robust inquiry capable of getting to the truth of what went wrong. And I welcome that that is happening, and that inquiry must and will report as soon as possible. But secondly, that regulations were brought forward to reduce to zero, so far as possible, any cost to the Northern Ireland public purse. And I welcome that this is the other critical step that is happening today. I strongly do not believe that the stepping aside issue should have brought about the situation where we find ourselves. I do not believe that Sinn Féin are justified in doing what they have done. Without a budget and without any contingency planning or preparation to bring down these institutions and the democratically elected people who serve in this chamber who were elected just 7 months ago. There were a number of different ways that this could have been approached. Sinn Féin argue that this election is about arrogance and corruption. Yet, the inquiry has not yet happened. There has been no findings of incompetence or corruption. The evidence of officials counter any allegations of wrongdoing, never mind corruption. And to quote from the Permanent Secretary, and to reference Permanent Secretary of Derry in his evidence to BAC, in his view, Arlene Foster did nothing wrong. Now, the inquiry will look at all of that. And once the inquiry looks at that and conclusions are drawn, then that is the time for action. But to prematurely bring down these institutions and fling around words such as corruption is wrong and unjustified. And all of that is set aside and beside the incredible position of Sinn Féin. Gerry Adams just last week put up a video in relation to the upcoming election, in which he quoted that this election is about accountability in public life. I find that absolutely astounding. From a party which, and members which, have yet to apologise for murder and maiming of thousands, and yes, that extends to Sinn Féin, because I look across on those benches week in and week out, and I see people with convictions in relation to these issues, and we have yet to hear an apology in relation to that.
Can I interrupt the member? Member straying too far from the debate on the regulations. I ask the member to come back to the debate.
Well, there are a series, and I won't ponder on that point too long, but there are a series of issues that have come up, and where these are relevant to these regulations, because this is what we need to do whenever we face challenges and difficulties. We need to bring forward solutions in relation to policy, we need to address the issue, we need to protect public funds, and we need to do what is right for people in Northern Ireland. And there have been a number of hurdles, there have been a number of scandals on all sides in relation to some issues that subsequently have been investigated, some of which have been left out there. And I don't believe that any one party is coming to the electorate with clean hands and being able to say, which Sinn Féin are trying to do, and to throw a lot of dirt before an inquiry has been heard. And I think that is absolutely critical. Before I finish, I want to say that, you know, I have been an MLA for just over a year. 7 months ago, I was hugely humbled to be elected to serve the people of South Belfast. And I made some reference earlier to the fact that there will be many people around this chamber who will not be coming back to serve their constituents and to serve the people of Northern Ireland. I do remain absolutely committed to doing what is right for Northern Ireland, to working as hard as I can, and I will continue to do that right up until the election, to give my support in all of this to try to find the right solutions for everybody. And I am saddened that at times, I think, reflecting over the course of this, there's just been a lot of party politics played, and I think that is not good for the people of Northern Ireland. I do think that we need to rise above that. We need to be objective. We need to look at the evidence in front of us. We need to be fair. And I think that if we do that, that every single party across this chamber should support these regulations today. We should ensure, as so far as we can, that the taxpayer in Northern Ireland, the public purse in Northern Ireland, does not pay out anything more than they have to in terms of the opportunity that is provided to us today. And that as we move forward, and regardless of whether I come back here or I don't, I am committed to working to build a better and a shared Northern Ireland. And I'll continue to do that in whatever role that I will play. But I do hope that everybody around this chamber commits to that and to works together today and moving forward to try to ensure that we do build a better Northern Ireland.
Well done.
Call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. And let me assure you, I will stick very tightly to the regulations. After all, the previous speaker has given a devastating critique of the failure of the so-called Fresh Start Executive. So my work in that regard is done, and I thank her for it. Let me begin by assuring the House the Ulster Unionist Party will not stand in the way of any initiative which is designed to stem the hemorrhaging of money, of public money, through the fatal flaw within the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme. As the person who last Monday proposed the adjournment for 7 days, I think it might be worth going back over the rationale for that, which was that I was concerned that there were several key areas where we lacked maximum certainty. And may I also put on record, in using standing orders to try and get an adjournment to the debate last week, I did not try to blindside the Minister. In fact, he can confirm that Danny Kennedy and I went to see him in his office sometime before the debate began. He greeted us very courteously. He was there with a witness, with John Robinson, before John recused himself from these issues. I told him what I was proposing, and I suggested that he contact the Northern Ireland office. And I believed that if he did, he would be given certainty that we would still be around today. Now, he chose to go ahead anyway, and at around 5:30, when the Secretary of State made his announcement with regard to the date of the election on the 2nd of March and the dissolution of this mandate, as you know, I got to my feet and I proposed the adjournment. So it was a matter of regret it had to be done that way, but I think it was the right thing to do because it gave 7 days, and I was clear, I think, to the Minister in terms of the assurances that we were looking for to be able to back these regulations. First of all, we had not heard from the examiner of statutory rules, the person who takes the technical look, the legal look on our behalf. Secondly, he had been to the Economy Committee earlier last Monday, but at the conclusion of that meeting, the committee had chosen to note rather than support the regulations on the basis that they had insufficient time to fully scrutinise what was being proposed. The third issue that I thought was critical was the lack of a business case. And the Minister made clear that he had been working on a business case, but there was no assurance given to the committee with regard to the case. And the fourth and final point that I had raised at the time was with regard to the European Union, because the examiner of statutory rules makes very clear in her report that these regulations will not necessarily begin on the 1st of April 2017. It will be that date or when the European Union gives their consent. And of course that could be sometime after the 1st of April, with the 85,000 a day being burnt off in the meantime. So let us go over the four areas. In the last 7 days... Oh, absolutely.
I think the member for giving way, but could I ask him just to clear up his language and maybe the reckless tone when he talks about money being burnt off. There are many, many credible businesses who are using this scheme in a legitimate way, many in his own constituency also, and mine, and everyone else's, who are using this for legitimate purposes with regards to the environment and also with regards to the incentive scheme, which they, in good faith, bought into.
I thank the member for his intervention, and he is absolutely right. And I think one of the great shames of this debacle, and when I'm using potentially emotive words, I'm being careful. Debacle is the word that the First Minister used to describe the scheme in this House. But the member is quite right. And yes, there are, and I've been speaking to constituents of mine who are signed up to the scheme. And I would put it to the member in this way. Over the course of the weekend, his colleague, the member for South Down, had to go to the media and say, a number of my relatives are availing of the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme. Does this not imply now that these relatives, there's some sort of innuendo against them, when all they've done is sign up for a scheme? And in fact, if it wasn't for the fact they were related to Mr. Wells, nobody would have a focus on them. And that is why, as a party, we have called for those relatives to have their boilers fast-tracked to the top of the list for an audit. Because if they've done nothing wrong, let us immediately, or as soon as possible, clear their name and let the public know they're simply availing of the scheme that was put before them. And I think that should be the case with anybody who comes into the public domain simply because they're related to an elected representative. So I absolutely agree.
I think the member for his patience and his indulgence, but I hear what he says, and I actually agree with the sentiments of that. But will he also agree with me that there have been businesses already tarnished in the media around this scheme when they should not have been? And the fact that when that is highlighted, it is scandalous, it's sensationalism, and when there has to be a retraction in the media, as he well knows, whether it's in the print or whether it's on TV, it is a small section of a reclaim or an apology. Will he acknowledge that?
And again, I thank the member for his intervention, and 100% no difficulty in acknowledging that. There is an expression that we all know, mud sticks, and it is unfair. Absolutely, let us look at what was done. There was a fatal flaw in the scheme. We know that now. The impact of that fatal flaw has been that some individuals and some companies have had a shadow cast over them. There is an allegation, there is an innuendo, there is a bad smell. And that is to be deeply regretted, and we must do what we can to try and assist putting their good name back into good standing. Absolutely.
I thank the member for giving way. Will you not agree that actually businesses come forward from the outset and say, we have availed of this RHI, but here's why and how we're using it legitimately? They could actually, pardon the pun, take some of the heat off themselves. As we've seen with the Mr. Wells case, I think you're probably being much more generous to him than you would have been if the media had found out the situation with his family, but because he came forward.
I thank the member for his intervention. I'm not going to comment further on Mr. Wells, because I do not think it is fair to relatives to be put into the public domain simply because they are related to somebody who sits in this house. As to the other matter about companies coming forward, what I noted over the weekend was the other, as it happens, the other unionist member for South Down was doing something different. He was getting an answer to a pertinent question, which reveals, I think it was 62%. 62% of applicants to this scheme were not applying for a replacement boiler so that they could migrate from oil or gas to biomass and to something renewable. 62% didn't have heating in the first place. So these were new installations. And the question must be asked, how does that help the environment when we're putting in, even though it is environmentally friendly compared to gas and oil, how does that help the environment when we're putting in even more heating installations? I give way to the member from East Belfast.
Yeah, I thank the member for giving way, and certainly I would share his concerns, though I would temper it against this. It did happen at a time when, for example, Moy Park were going through quite a large expansion, and so some of those new installations will have been for new sheds that were being built to do with the expansion of the business. So a proportion of them will be, if you like, genuine new heating installations that would have been happening anyway. But I think you're absolutely right when the member says that he would want to know how many fall into each category.
And I thank the member for her for intervention. I let the point rest, because I promised the Speaker I would stick as tightly as possible to the regulations. And again, I think we maybe are straying a tad. So within the 4 points, some are directly, I think, within the gift of the Minister to action over the last 7 days. Some are not. For example, the examiner of statutory rules obviously will take the time she needs to take, but she has now reported. And I don't think anybody could put their hand on their heart in this chamber, having read the report of the examiner, and say she's happy. She might be content, just about content, because she certainly makes it clear, to my mind, that a judicial review, that a legal challenge, is pretty much inevitable. And we know there is that grouping, that sort of consortium of RHI users who are getting very well organised and have made it clear that they will seek a judicial review of what is going on. And the concern of that has to be that it could end up actually costing the public purse more, because the $85,000 a day continues to have to be spent if they're successful with their judicial review, and then there's the cost of the review itself. And also there is the issue of whether it is actually compliant with human rights. So I would ask the Minister, and we'll be listening very, very carefully, because we certainly do not want to stand in the way of any worthwhile attempt to stop the hemorrhaging here. So we'll be listening carefully for his assessment of the report of the examiner of statutory rules. But she's made it clear, with limited opportunity for scrutiny, it is effectively impossible for any of us in this chamber, to take a definitive view of these regulations. And indeed, I listened to the Permanent Secretary, Dr. Andrew McCormick, who was at committee earlier today, and effectively what he was saying was, what we have here is the best available. Very different from good, very different from sound, solid, as good as it gets, just within the context. This is the best available. And I think that's a fair assessment. And I would also say, I think Dr. McCormick has done more than anybody I've heard over the last number of weeks to try to maintain the integrity of these devolved institutions, and I thank him for that. So today, the committee had the opportunity to shift their position from having noted the regulations to approving the regulations, but they didn't. The Minister did not turn up, and we'll certainly again be listening very carefully to Mr. Hamilton when he speaks as to why he was not able to attend committee today. Surely, if we are looking for a consensual way forward, the Minister would have made time for his committee. But let us not prejudge. We will wait and hear what the Minister has to say. Then there's the business case, and here we look to the partners of the DUP in government, to Sinn Féin, because from what I'm hearing, it's stuck in the Department of Finance. The Department of Finance could have come to the House and told us the business case is fine, let's move forward. They had a week, but what happened over the week? It seemed to be the two departments, economy and finance, were in a race to see who could be first to commission an inquiry under the 2005 Inquiries Act. And bizarrely, I have to just put on record, Mr. Speaker, I was unable, first of all, I was contacted by representatives of both ministers and was unable to take the call directly on both occasions. When the finance minister's people contacted me, I was at an event on Saturday and wasn't able to reply for several hours, but there was no harm done because that was Saturday and he wanted a meeting on Monday. Before that, representatives of Minister Hamilton in the economy had contacted me. That was on Thursday. I was unable to directly respond to the call because I was at a funeral. By the time I did respond, the meeting had already begun that they wanted me at to discuss the Department of the Economy bringing forward an inquiry. And indeed, as I later learned, the Finance Minister had already got to the point of announcing an inquiry. So there is a matter for regret, but on the record, that is why I did not attend the meeting that the Economy Minister wished me to attend on Thursday to discuss the possibility of him bringing forward an inquiry. The fourth and final point Mr. Speaker, is with regard to the European Union. As the statutory examiner made clear, these regulations, if approved, will not necessarily kick in on the 1st of April because they also need to be approved by the European Union. And specifically, we have to know if they are compliant with Article 107 of the Treaty of the Functioning of the European Union. In the last 7 days, I certainly have not heard anything in terms of an opinion coming from the Department. I don't believe the committee has been given any assurances in that regard. So once again, this is something we will be listening to the Minister to see if there's certainty. So it is a lack of certainty that we are trying to address. It was for that reason I thought a gap of 7 days would be useful. We have come to the end of the 7 days and very little additional certainty has been added. And so we will listen to the rest of the debate, Mr. Speaker, and particularly to the words of the Minister.
Well, Mr. Gordon Lyons.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to take part in this debate. And first of all, I want to begin by welcoming the regulations that we have in front of us this afternoon. I also welcome the opportunity that we had over the last week as a committee to look at them in more detail, to be able to get evidence from the Renewable Heat Association and from the Permanent Secretary of the Department for the Economy. I believe that those discussions were useful. I believe that we are better informed now than we were 7 days ago. However, it is clear that these regulations will significantly reduce the cost of the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme in the next financial year and will effectively keep us within the original budget. I think this is what the public want to see. We're all aware of the public concern, the public interest and indeed the public anger in regards to this issue, and I'm pleased that progress is being made in terms of instilling confidence in the public or reinstating the public's confidence once again because of the public inquiry that has been announced, and that's very welcome, and I'll not obviously stray in to those issues, Mr. Speaker, other than to say it is welcome that that is happening. But the other thing that the public want to see are cost controls. I think most of the public anger in relation to this issue has come from the fact that this has the potential to have so much of an overspend on our budget. And there are concerns in relation to allegations of fraud and indeed overcompensation as well. And I think it is important for us to remember that being a recipient of this scheme does not mean that the recipient has been doing or is doing anything wrong. Legitimate applicants should not have their reputations tarnished or their integrity questioned, and I think it's very important that we put that on the record again. However, the way in which the uptake of the scheme developed has meant that action needs to be taken so that we can avoid further negative implications on our budget in years to come. And the regulations, briefly, yes.
Would the member acknowledge that the cost of the scheme, the £25-30 million a year, would have been fully known over a year ago? So can he explain why the current proposals, which have just been out a matter of days, was not brought forward 1 year ago so that there could have been full scrutiny and a much higher level of certainty going forward as to what might be the implications of such legislation?
Well, indeed, that question was asked this morning at the Economy Committee, and indeed the Permanent Secretary had answered that there had been various plans and different proposals were being considered in the Department, but this was the one that has come now. And I will come on to this in just a second, because I think it is important that we take the time to get this right, which is one of the reasons why I think it is correct that there is a one-year interim solution to this, and we have a time for a longer-term scheme to be addressed after that. I'll give away to Mr. Frew.
On the point that the other member raised, does the member not realise that it was brought up last year. It was even in this very House when the then Minister, Jonathan Bell, came here to close the scheme. And he would have been fully aware, he would have been fully aware at that time of why the scheme had to be closed, because the then Minister, Jonathan Bell, actually talked about that very thing. So, and of course, the members across the chamber will know how they voted and how they didn't vote when closing the scheme. But to say that we were not aware is completely untrue. And if people are only coming to this now in mid or late autumn, that says more about them than it does for this Assembly. Thank you.
Thank the member for his intervention. I think he sat down just in time before he was about to receive a rebuke from the Speaker. But I think we're in the situation now where we want to have a solution to this. We want to be able to control the costs of it. And in order for us to do that properly over the long term, I think it is right that we have something in place now that can deal with the next financial year. And the regulations that are before the House this afternoon address the worst excesses of the scheme and that which has been the cause of so much public concern and anger and potential negative consequences for the executive. So these regulations are only for 1 year. It is an interim solution, but it does have the potential to save £28 million. And we have been told also in our briefings from the department that those savings could be even greater, depending upon improved enforcement and the different attitudes that users are taking in regards to changed behaviour. There is a sunset clause on these regulations as well. So I think it is appropriate. I think the right steps have been taken in the way in which this has been brought in as a short-term measure, and it will give us that extra time that members and that the department and that the Renewable Heat Association are looking for, so that we can address this in a better way in the longer term. Because nobody, I believe, in this House today, Mr. Speaker, believes that the regulations that are in front of us are the perfect solution to the problems that we are facing. A delay in this debate for a week. I'll just finish this point first. A delay for a week has allowed us to have an additional degree of scrutiny, but it is obviously not the type of scrutiny that we should be accustomed to in this House. But it is action for the next financial year, and I think that's important. I'll give way to Dr. Farrey.
Yeah, thank the member for giving way. Just to invite the member just to concur and to the House that, under scrutiny to the committee, the Permanent Secretary has actually suggested that potentially the more favourable approach in the long term, subject to public consultation, may well be the run-on of this current approach, which again begs the question as to why this didn't come forward sooner. But just to invite the member to recognise that there is a view amongst officials in the department at this stage that this may actually be the preferred approach, subject to the consultation ratifying that over the next 12 months.
And of course, that's the important point. It's subject to consultation, and the Renewable Heat Association made the point whenever they were before the committee last week that for them they wanted to have more consultation before any final decision is made on the longer-term programme. But certainly it was the view of the Permanent Secretary, I believe, and I hope I'm not misquoting him here, that it certainly provides the basis for where we go in the future. But that's the whole point of a consultation, is that we're not predetermining anything and that we're allowing opportunities for people to have their say. And if better options can come to the fore, then we will obviously look at those and accept those. Just want to mention briefly some of the conversations and discussions that we have had within the Committee for the Economy in relation to these regulations. I want to begin by thanking the Clerk and his staff in the Committee for the work that they have done over the last number of weeks. They have been putting a lot of work in regards to organising a lot of extra meetings and giving us the opportunity to have a greater look at what these regulations say and what these regulations will mean. When the Minister appeared before the committee last week, he indicated that these regulations were right for us to support because they, first of all, address the excesses and the worst excesses of the scheme. They will relieve the pressure on the budget and will support those who legitimately applied. And I think that those are the things that should be guiding our thoughts at this time, and in particular the public interest in regards to the money that would be spent if we don't take any action. I think it is important that we reiterate that doing nothing is not an option. I want to also thank Dr. McCormick for his appearances before the committee, because I think that we gleaned an awful lot of useful information from him. And just want to set out some of the things that he has said to us as we met. He was very clear that he has an obligation as the accounting officer for the department to sort this out and to make sure that he keeps his books a balance. He said that there was no quicker or better option. He said that the public interest was not served well with the current tariffs. He said that these regulations were a very defensible, very viable set of proposals, that they were the only means available to stop hemorrhaging of funds. He said that it was a very strong option and that the rationale for supporting these were clearly there. And so I think that his evidence has made it clear to us the importance of getting cost control measures in place and the detrimental effect that doing nothing would have. And indeed, if these regulations are not brought in, we're going to have to look at finding the money from elsewhere, and perhaps finding the money from within the Department for the Economy budget. And we know that there are many other priorities there in terms of Invest NI, in terms of higher education, in terms of skills, in terms of promoting our country through tourism. And so we need to be realistic as well as we meet here today. We don't have the comfort of being able to say, well, I don't really like these regulations, so we'll do nothing. Doing nothing has very serious consequences as well. It was also very useful for us to be able to take evidence from the Renewable Heat Association. And it was very clear that they had a considerable interest in regards to these issues. But when questioned, it was clear that they did not have an alternative option that could begin to deal with this issue in this financial year. They certainly were speaking and talking about options that would be further down the road, but that would not address the initial overspend that we would be facing or the implications that would have on the Department for the Economy budget and perhaps other departmental budgets. I also asked different members of the association that were before us if they believed that a rate of return of around 50 or 60 or even 70% was considered excessive. I asked that question a number of times, and I don't think anyone was able to give a straight answer in relation to that. Their main point was that there should have been a greater degree of consultation in regards to these regulations. That obviously was not able to be an option for us, because we know that the time pressures that we are under. We know that because of the actions of Sinn Féin, that this Assembly will not be in existence after Wednesday. We do not have the luxury of taking more time. So if we want to get this situation dealt with, if we want to make sure that there isn't an overspend in the next financial year, this needs to be dealt with now. And I think it was Mr. Aiken, who's not in this place, had earlier on said that this is costing £85,000 every day. If we are concerned about that loss of money to other priorities, if we do want to see cost control measures brought in, if we do want to ensure that this issue is addressed and tackled, and the public know that there will not be an overspend of the magnitude that had previously been reported, then we need to support these regulations. And indeed, it is the only show in town. It was, as the Permanent Secretary has said, the best available option. And that's why it is right as well, and we say this again, that it is a one-year scheme that gives us the opportunity to be able to further consider this again. I'll give way to Mr. Lund.
Mr. Lund, for giving way. Just on the question he raised a moment ago about the consultation,
and the fact that time constraint didn't allow for any kind of a proper consultation period. These regulations aren't going to take effect until the 1st of April. Would he not agree that that would have allowed time for a consultation period, even if it had before shortened?
Time for consultation, Mr. Speaker, but it would give us absolutely no time to get them passed in this House. Tomorrow is D-Day, or possibly Wednesday if there were to be a special sitting of the Assembly. But that's it. The opportunity would be gone for us. And really that would then in effect mean that the consultation would be worthless. So I think that that addresses the point that the member makes. Mr. Speaker, I hope that members will support the regulations that we have here in front of us. Claire Hannah, who previously spoke at the beginning of the debate last week, had set out her position. However, what was lacking was a clear alternative. What else do we do? And it's very clear to members today that we either support the regulations that are here in front of us or allow that overspend. So many people across the country and so many people in this chamber have spoken out against and have been so angry about. Failure to support these regulations will allow that to continue in the next financial year. I don't think that that would be appropriate. I don't think that is what anybody wants to see happen. You know, I do think that so much of this debate around this issue over the last number of weeks has been about trying to hurt or to damage Arlene Foster in some way. And I think it was very telling from Mr. Alistair's point earlier on when he accused my colleague, Mrs. Little-Pengelly, and said to her, stop trying to shift the blame, stop trying to smear others. I think that's very telling, because I think that's what he and others are trying to do. They're trying to smear Arlene Foster. And whenever he said, stop trying to smear others, I think it revealed what he was really doing whenever he spoke. So I hope that members will, on this occasion, be able to put the party politics to the side. There's an election coming up and we'll have lots of time for all of that sort of stuff. But right now, the position that we are in requires action, and that's why it is important that these regulations are supported, and that's what I hope that members will do today. Thank you.
Before I call Ms. Sinead Bradley, I have to remind her that question time is at 2 p.m. and I may need to interrupt her if she's continuing to speak. She will then, of course, be called to speak after question time. Ms. Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate that. Firstly, as I stand to my feet, I was hopeful that the extension of 7 days from last week's debate would have offered a genuine opportunity for those who were focused on not just an inquiry, but actually trying to stop the hemorrhage of what is public money that should and could be spent on better things such as hospitals, education, and I could go on. And in the hope that that would happen, I have to, at the outset, register my disappointment that former members of the executive and members of committee from Sinn Féin did not choose to attend committee meetings to discuss this point. It's particularly difficult to witness that happen at a time when they are otherwise very busy on the airwaves trying to play the blame game and essentially rushing to the front line in terms of getting the headline. Yes, I would give way.
The member for South Down wouldn't be suggesting for 1 second the Minister for Finance would be some sort of a vainglorious person who loves media attention.
I'd never dare make such an assertion. However, I do think it's particularly disappointing because there are clearly two bodies of work at play here. It is in everybody's interest that the truth of who knew what, when, and what exactly happened, it is in everybody's interest that that does come to light, because only in that coming to the public light will lessons be learned from this. But there is that second body of work which there appears to be little to no appetite for, and I say that across political parties and across the media. If my house was on fire, would I put the fire out and then investigate how it started? Or would I investigate it while the fire is raging? And quite frankly, what's been happening in this house, the DUP Sinn Féin executive behind their iron curtain of politics that has set a tone that is not befitting of the Good Friday Agreement or any politics going forward, have watched the fire rage. And nobody saw fit to say, should we be putting this out? Yes, I will give way.
The member will be aware of the continued attempts by our members to this side to create the fallacy that the SDLP are in some way solely responsible for the botched scheme and voted for the botched scheme. Could the member please put on record the actual facts and the truth?
Absolutely, and I will, you know, it's the single red herring that Sinn Féin have left to hide their blushes. We all know that at that time it was the legitimate scheme that should have been produced and laid out at the outset. Had that been the case, we actually may have had a very good scheme in place. But that wasn't the case. But that is the little leaflet, no doubt Sinn Féin will try and hoodwink and convince the electorate that somehow they had no duty over their mandate in this Assembly to do anything which was to essentially stop the hemorrhaging of public money. Now, I will actually, yes, I will give way very happily because I haven't heard from you in over 2 weeks on this issue when you had the opportunity, so I'd be very, very minded to be brought up to date on your thinking on this.
Well, I appreciate that the member wasn't here last February and that's so therefore she had no role in the last discussions. But the member would need to be aware that her party did, in fact, vote against the proposal to close the scheme last February 2016. So that is a reality, that is a fact. You can say all you want about it. You voted against, as did the Ulster Unionist Party, the closure of the scheme, despite repeated warnings about the cost that was going to be accrued and lost to the public purse. So your party voted against closing the scheme. Simple fact. You can't get around that. I know you weren't here at the time, so it's not your fault, neither was Justin here at the time, but your party as a party and other members who are still here and who were here last year did vote to close the scheme.
Thank you, Mr. Maskey, for that intervention, and I thank you that you say it wasn't my fault, and you're right, I wasn't here, but you were here, and isn't it shameful that you then are dependent on a member who was not present to actually clarify to you that should know better what happened? The scheme that was voted on in February
Ask the member to retain her seat. I ask Mr. Maskey, I ask you to refrain from speaking from a sedentary position.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Point of order, Mr. Stafford.
Mr. Speaker, there has been a consistent pattern over the course of the last fortnight of Sinn Féin members heckling other speakers from a sedentary position. Can you please advise them that if they want to participate in the functions of this House, they can list their name and come and speak like every other member that was elected here?
I think I have already dealt with the matter. Member, continue.
I will continue, and I will continue for the benefit of Mr. Maskey in particular, who clearly does not understand the facts of the case. The amended scheme, which was a scheme that had tariffs and caps applied, was presented to this House in February. You are right. You were present. I was not. The member might be disappointed to learn that this member can read. This member can take facts.
No points of information in this chamber. There's no. Just remain your seat.
I will just finish my point firstly, just for Mr. Maskey's benefit. Mr. Maskey and his party might do well to revise the official Hansard at that time. And there you will find a very well-considered scheme that was measured, that had it been used at the outset, would have avoided totally the saga that's in front of us today. However, on that date, when the SDLP presented themselves here, they, like other members in this House, were very mindful that the quick execution and the early closure of that scheme was placing legitimate businesses and legitimate access to that scheme, that was putting them at risk, because there were people who had signed up to a very good, worthwhile scheme at that stage. I'll finish my point. A very good, worthwhile scheme at that time. Those businesses were in the process of realising orders coming into their businesses. They were in the process of installing these boilers. And again, I repeat, with the measures in place that should have been there from the outset. So, Mr. Maskey, your little red herring has just died. And what I suggest is, if you cannot use facts, say nothing, because it is not good enough to come here
the member has indicated she's not giving way.
Use interventions to try and somehow demine me and say that you weren't here, your knowledge base would not be quite the same as mine. Well, unfortunately, Mr. Maskey, my knowledge base is based on fact, not on spin, not on trying to somehow deceive the electorate and say that you had no part to play in this. And quite frankly, while we're at it, we will ask the question, why did Sinn Féin not want a public inquiry? What was the reason? Why was there an extended delay in this? Perhaps a suspicious mind might actually think maybe there's something that they're a little bit uncomfortable with that could be laid bare. And imagine that would happen on the eve of an election. Let's just get the votes in first, get to the facts later. That appears to be Sinn Féin's position on this. But I will go back to, and I will use my opportunity to inform you further, Mr. Maskey, of what happened at the Economy Committee today, which you chose not to be present at. There was legal advice brought to the Economy Committee. And at that, a legal pathway was set that the Minister could pursue with this regulation and amendment to it. It was set out how that might be possible, and it was also set out to us quite clearly the problems and the areas that we may have reason to have concern about. Also presented to the Economy Committee was the legal pathway that those recipients of RHI funding could also pursue the courts. There was very clear indications that they had equally a pathway to follow up that their contracts with the department were not being honoured. And I have no doubt that it is not the job of this House to judge or measure which of those two legal pathways holds the most weight. But I have no doubt in the decision that's being presented in front of us today, I have no doubt that a judicial review is highly, highly likely. And it has been made clear to us why that is highly likely. So let it be placed on record that nobody in this House believes what in front of us today is anything near perfect. In fact, the week that's in it was able to highlight perhaps many of the imperfections that do exist.
Can I interrupt the member at this stage? I need to deal with a point of order raised by Mr. Dixon before we go to question time. Does the member wish to continue her debate after question time?
The member most certainly does. Thank you.